everyone, and welcome to Beyond Focus TV. My name is Angie Daniel, and I am your hostess for the show. Tonight, we have with us Ms. Colette Ellis. She is the founder of NSTEP Consulting. We're going to take a short break. When I come back, I'll introduce her to you. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Before I took a break, I did tell you that I was going to introduce to you Ms. Ellis. She is the founder of NSTEP Consulting. Welcome, Ms. Ellis.
Thank you, Angie. Great to be here.
Thank you for coming. While reading the program online, and I wanted the community to understand the largest step of what NSTEP Consulting stands for.
Absolutely, great. So NSTEP Consulting, we are a coaching and consulting company, and our focus is really to help people to get in step with their health. So that can be via coaching programs that we offer to people one-on-one, and we also go into organizations and offer wellness seminars, retreats, and all designed to help people to take on healthy living strategies and make healthy living fun.
Okay, I kind of like that. I have a question for you, but I wanted to, I have a second part to my question beforehand,
sure.
And before I get into the wellness part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Why did you create NSTEP Consulting?
That's a great question. So I actually, NSTEP Consulting as a brand, if you will, was born back in 2004. But I've been doing coaching and consulting since the late 90s.
Okay.
I've worked in human resources. I've worked in e-learning. And then I also got my stress management certification. So this is an opportunity for me
to bring all three together.
Exactly.
Good.
Exactly.
Good.
So, and it really is all about people, right?
Yeah.
Because our companies, our organizations, our communities are all made up of people.
Mm-hmm.
And so my goal is really to help people to be successful by feeling good on the inside and then reflecting that back on the outside.
Because it's like, you know, the human resources part, and for you to understand how a company works, for me, I think it's an aspect that, like, everyone can benefit from.
Right.
Would you say that in coaching, because
mm-hmm.
you do personal coaching,
yes.
Part, like, if someone would come to you and then they need to get their career in gear
mm-hmm.
in term of, like, making a career change, would they come to NSTEP Consult?
They could. I mean, I actually have done career coaching,
mm-hmm.
and what I always say is also I've had a number of transitions in my life. I've worked in the not-for-profit sector, I've worked in the for-profit sector, and now I'm an entrepreneur. So, and so I understand what it means to make those transitions. And in today's economy, it often might mean that someone needs to go from one sector to another, or they may need to go from one industry to another. So what I can help people do is be able to tell that story in a compelling way so that the new employer can understand. Because, you know, we've all looked
yes.
for jobs in our
yes.
lives, right? and I remember there were times where I thought, well, you know, I just walked in with my resume. They should get it. Right? You can
it's
read.
True.
It's there.
Yeah.
But in reality, as job seekers, we're still responsible for being able to tell that story and walk someone through.
Yeah, that first letter.
Right. But because the whole thing, you know, you need to get in the door,
mm-hmm.
you know, so having the keywords and all that stuff in your resume. But when you're fortunate enough to have that meeting with someone, you need to be able to tell a story that's compelling enough that shows what you can add to that organization.
It is, and to me, that's extremely stressful
mm-hmm.
on both part. You
mm-hmm.
know, like I know when you're creating resumes, there's
right.
like all these different target ways of creating that,
right.
where you'd pick the specific word, and then like you matching company to your personality,
right?
And then how, you know, sometimes it's not a perfect match,
right? Right. And you know, and I think that I agree with you that it can be stressful. I think
mm-hmm.
that, so that means that you always need to have your support team.
Mm-hmm.
So coaches are great, you know, family, friends, people that can sort of help keep you, keep your morale up
mm-hmm.
While you're doing a job search, because, you know, we know that now it seems to be for many people, it's taking longer and longer. Mm-hmm. So you really need to have that champion of the team of champions that are going to help support you through that process.
Okay. My second part to the question is that, mm-hmm. what are the values that you would say you are looking for in a person coming to you, or what you would have to offer to them after a meeting?
Do you mean someone to work that? Mm-hmm. Oh, right. So well, one of the things, whether it's a coach or coaching or a consulting assignment, I really like to meet people where they are. And that was really the thought process behind the naming of In-Step Consulting, was to be in step with our clients. So some of our values are integrity, you know, doing what you say you're going to do, and letting people know. So if there's something that we've, you know, committed to doing for a client, obviously, we're going to commit to that, and if there's anything that's going to get in the way of that, we want to let people know as soon as possible. So things like integrity, things like collaboration, we're very collaborative. Again, meeting people where they are, trying to work with them to make their organization more successful. Learning, I think, is another one of our key values in terms of continuous learning and being able to stay on top of all of the things that are happening in our world, and also trying to learn as much as we can about the industries that we're serving.
Okay. We're going to take a break. Mm-hmm. When we come back, we're going to talk about the wellness part of getting the employer wellness program.
Okay.
So we're going to take a short break. We'll be right back. Welcome back. We are here with Ms. Ellis. She is the founder of In-Step Consulting. Before we took a break, we were talking about like how you integrate wellness programs within companies. Mm-hmm. Can you explain to me what that is?
Sure. So we there are a few things that we do. We participate in company health fairs, mm-hmm. and we actually can help people. Help organizations maybe that don't have those health fairs, we can make connections to help them actually set those up. But those are great days where employees can come down to a conference room and get access to, usually there's maybe a nurse on site or that would take a blood pressure, or during certain seasons maybe they're getting a flu shot. Okay. And then there are also, you know, companies like ours and other alternative health providers that are there to just sort of check in with employees and see where they are, because I think prevention is really a key part to wellness, both personal wellness as well as organizational wellness. So kind of getting that check your engine light, or sort of getting that dashboard. So really trying to help the organization see where are the potential hot spots as it relates to stress, as it may relate to other types of illnesses that people are dealing with in the workplace.
I know the stressing is one of the biggest things that you do within companies.
Mm-hmm.
So can you explain how you get companies to help employees de-stress themselves or manage their stress level?
Absolutely. So I think, so one of the things, we have various assessments that we can use, so people can actually complete those assessments anonymously, and we can aggregate that information. So to get a sense of, so there's different types of stress. Maybe it's something that is related to what's happening on the job, or it could be something that's happening in their work, in their personal or their family side. So we look at work and family stress. Because if someone is, even if the workplace environment is, you know, relaxing and calm and things are going well, if they're dealing with, say, a sick family member or they themselves have a particular illness, mm-hmm. it still can impact their level of stress. So we want to help people figure out what's going on, kind of what we call, what are your stress triggers?
Okay.
What are those things that make you feel anxious and feel like
deadline?
Right. So the work side could be deadlines.
Yes.
It could be perhaps there's not enough coverage or support on the team. So we really try to figure out what the issues are, because so we sort of see it along what I call like a stress skills ladder.
Okay.
And so the goal is to move people up the ladder so that they're first physically able to manage their responses to stress. So we talk about things like deep breathing and meditation. And then ideally, as you work your way up the ladder, say it is something to do with a deadline, that's a great example. How can you problem solve to potentially maybe eliminate or reduce reduce that as a stress trigger. So we really look at people from a holistic perspective, what's going on sort of inside and also what's going on in their environment.
Because I think how you feel about yourself within a company, it gives you a better idea of what it is that you can offer to the company. I remember I used to work for a company where they had yoga like twice a week.
That's great.
You know, just to help the employees. Mm-hmm. And then there was also sessions where people who did not like yoga, they wanted to do other things like have tea at 3 o'clock in the
Right.
night. But it's not every company or not that many companies that will offer that to you. What are the different alternatives to, like, let's say, I'll use a facility like a healthcare facility.
Sure.
Which is, to me, it's extremely stressful. Mm-hmm. What would be the alternative of, like, yoga or other things that they can do within a day to help the employees reduce stress?
Mm-hmm. So there's things about the organizational things like scheduling and those kinds of things that we were talking about, looking at those things like, is there sufficient coverage for whatever, you know, for the departments, because that can be a really big source of stress in the workplace. And then other things, so again, you want to meet people where they are. So maybe there's a quiet room, a space where people can go and not, you know, can unplug. So, you know, a phone free, you know, computer free.
Computer free.
Room space.
Other people free.
Right.
Just your own little space.
Right, where maybe there's music or something that plays in the background. And again, so certain things or doing things like, we also work with companies to help them to potentially do healthy challenges.
Okay.
So aligned with, say, Nutrition Month, making sure that there's, you know, water and healthy snacks available in the cafeteria. Maybe doing some sort of a challenge around walking more, or, you know, I've heard of companies that have, you know, given their employees pedometers and they have this challenge. It was one organization, it's called, like, they're doing something called Steps to Paris.
Yes.
So there's something like a million steps between here and Paris, and the employees are wearing pedometers, and the challenge is that the team that has the most walks the most steps actually will get to go to Paris.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Mm,
that's a good challenge.
Right.
And then understanding the idea of health in itself, you know, not even as an employee, really.
Right.
It's just you as a person to understand, like, the benefit of de-stressing yourself. Because I think a lot of times what we do is that we take every part of our lives and make it into one big bowl of problems that we carry with us at all times.
Right.
And people don't understand the difference of, like, okay, this is at home, I'm going to keep this at home, and this is work. So those two, I mean, regardless of how you want to integrate all of your problems or your whole life, it really should be cut into, like, to me, I try my best to do that, to cut my life into different pieces, like, where I'm a mother, I'm an employee, I am me, you know, like, you give yourself different time, and a lot of time, like, you have to teach yourself to do that. Or in a way to distress yourself. I mean, exercise is one way to distress yourself. Another part for me is how you can separate your livelihood, like, in terms of, like, small part.
Right. Well, I mean, and that's actually an exercise that I do with people. It's a role exercise where, you know, we take a circle and I tell them to divide the pie or the circle into the various roles that they play based on, you know, how much time in one example, and then what's the level of importance. Because sometimes where the stress conflict comes from, time is being spent in one area, even though another area you may say, this is my priority.
Exactly.
And so it's looking at what are those things that get in the way of, so if, you know, family is that higher priority, are there things that are maybe getting in the way of you spending time with your family, and how do you kind of reorder or reconfigure the schedule? Because I think we ideally would like to think that we can keep everything
separate.
But, you know, again,
ideally.
When things are going well, you can, most of us can multitask and do lots of different things. What happens sometimes when we feel stressed is that something goes wrong in one area, and now that impacts all of the other areas.
I have a very good question for you, but we're going to take a short break, and then when I come back, I'll ask it.
Okay.
We'll be right back. Welcome back to Beyond Focus TV. I am Angie Daniel. We are here with Ms. Ellis. She is the founder of NSTEP Consulting. Before we took a break, I did tell you that I had a question for you. I'm not sure how appropriate or how explainable this question is, but how do you help someone mm-hmm. who's living a certain lifestyle that is not appropriate to their work environment, or, you know, like those two cannot combine into one? How do you help them out mm-hmm. of that type of situation?
Mm-hmm. Sure. I think part of it is doing what I call reconnect to your purpose. Mm-hmm. So it's looking at what are your values? You know, you asked the question earlier about, you know, in-step consulting and my values and our values.
Yeah.
So I think I walk people through that type of an exercise of coming up with your values and what are the statements of those values. So like when I said integrity to me means doing what I say I'm going to do. So helping people to review and clarify their values, looking at their goals, and then really exploring what is that like in your work environment mm-hmm. and helping them to see, is there an alignment? Is there a fit? Is it in step? Or are there ways where it's not in alignment? And I think that then the courageous step becomes, okay, what are we going
to
do?
What are we going to
do about it? Right, yeah. Right. So, and is it something that you can do in the existing environment, as in I need to have conversation with this person, or maybe I need to look at a different role within that organization? Or
yes.
is it something like, this isn't the right fit, I don't see the right path, and it might mean going to another place.
But that's such a scary thing
mm-hmm.
to do.
Absolutely.
For you to say, okay, I know, like, for example, I have a degree in A.
Mm-hmm.
I'm working as B.
Right.
And I know I want to get to C.
Right.
You understand?
Yes.
How do I make A and B work for me so I can get to C? Because a lot of times, like, I think as people, we get comfortable
right
where we are at.
Mm-hmm.
And it becomes very afraid to kind of, like, take chances and make changes.
Right.
You know, like, how do you, personally, for me, I think mm-hmm. it's one of those things that I'm very afraid of. I love being comfortable.
Right.
I love being comfortable. So it's really hard for me to take a step forward to
right.
other things.
Right.
And, you know, to get people to do that, it's really hard. And that's how, like, you know, getting to your, like, the third part of what you do.
Right.
Is you do consultation with women.
Women, yes.
Getting into businesses.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Elaborate a little bit more.
Sure. I mean, I think that's natural. So the first part is that you're not alone, I'm not alone. And we've all had various times in our lives where making that leap mm-hmm. was a challenge. And whether or not you choose to make the leap. In some of my situations in the past, I've had rugs pulled out from under me. So sometimes
yeah, I think that's a better push.
Well, but sometimes
me, it would work.
Right.
You know.
So the universe will send something, and mm-hmm. you know, so you can look at something as a door closing
or and a window opening up.
A window opening up. But to your point, particularly about people who want to launch their own businesses, you know, and I can personally relate to that. I think that sometimes it can be, first of all, it's figuring out what's the vision. So focusing mm-hmm. on your vision and identifying where you'd like to see yourself going. And then thinking about what are the steps that you're going to take to get there. So depending on the type of business, sometimes people can do, you know, what they call the side hustle, where they can start aspects of their business while working for someone else.
Mm-hmm.
Then it becomes a matter of figuring out what that balance,
time.
The time.
Like,
right. And also thinking about your business, the target market, and the lifestyle that you would like to have as a result of that.
The end result.
Yeah. Because the lifestyle might mean, okay, I want to be able to spend more time with my family, so how can I create a business structure that allows me to do that? Who do I need to put in place? Mm-hmm. Who do I have to have on my team, either on the family side or on the business side, to create that support so that, I think that one of the other challenges sometimes as women, and men too, mm-hmm. sometimes as well, is that we feel like we have to do it all ourselves.
Yes.
So I think that even with starting a business on the side, there are ways that you can still outsource different aspects of your business to be able to still manage that, you know, the side hustle, the work, and potentially family.
So if I were to come up to you with an idea of, like, okay, this is what I want to do,
mm-hmm.
you'd work me through, okay, first, this is your idea. How can it work, and where do you go from here?
Right, and my work with you would be a bit more on the life and the lifestyle side of that.
Okay.
With some aspects, you know, I can provide some advice around the business side, but I also have, again, I have a network of people, so that, you know, I have business attorneys, finance people, so there are also other referrals that I can make. So because from my perspective, I wouldn't take on things that I can't do as well. And I think that, so the other thing is to think about, you know, what is the support that you need for yourself? What is the support you need for your business? And try to get as many of those players in the mix as you can.
So because I know we have, like, almost at the end of our show, what I wanted to the community to actually understand is that if you have an idea, if they have a, because I think too many of us have ideas and we're just sitting on it, not making it work for ourselves. So to find a person like yourself, like as a coach, to help them through it, is there a number? Is there a way they can get in touch with you? And, you know, so what would be your number and address, any way they can get in touch?
Sure. So our website is instepconsulting.com, which is I-N-S-T-E-P consulting.com. And our email is info@instepconsulting.com. I'm also an avid tweeter, so if you're on Twitter, I'm all about social media. So my my profile is Coach Colette, Coach underscore Colette, and our business number is 646-450-4380.
And again, you do, self-help consultation work with individuals,
right?
And I know a lot of people who have businesses that they would love to branch out. And ideas they would love to create. It's just like a matter of how do you get from point A to B?
Right.
And a lot of times people don't know. They want to do it. They have the idea.
Right.
They don't know how to branch it out.
Right.
And to get in touch with a company like you, like yours, or a person like yourself, it would be a great thing for us to do. And this is the end of our show. Is there any last words you would like to say to the public, or if anybody would want to get some information from you?
Sure. I think for business owners or potential business owners, it really is taking that leap of faith to pursue your idea. And maybe contrary to what others might tell you, is to share your idea, to get that feedback, because sometimes people think, oh,
it's my idea, and I don't want to tell anyone.
So for example, you know, we're looking to do some technology in healthcare, and I've been telling people about, you know, the different types of apps that we want to develop, just as an opportunity to get feedback from others. So I think that, and then finding your support team, whether it's coaches, other advisors, trying to find also a group of people that are in your same field or industry to talk to people that are positive.
So.
No, you're right. Yeah, trying to stay away from the energy vampires.
And,
Definitely. Although I think to balance that, sometimes you do need someone that can be your own devil's advocate. So someone that you trust that won't be a complete yes person.
Yeah,
which is different from negative.
Yeah, but you don't want somebody to just kill your dreams.
Right. Exactly. Right. So stay away from the energy vampires, stick with positive people, and also find your own personal person that you can trust that may give you the more constructive feedback that that you may not be aware of, the honest feedback that you may not be receiving from others.
Well, thank you so much. I think this is it. This is the end of our show. Thank you for watching. I will see you next Tuesday, same place, same time. Thank you, Ms. Ellis.
Thank you. It was great.
Yeah.